We have the phase model of our clock and data recovery circuit, and we did this for a case where we don't have the forwarded clock. Okay, and this is the phase of the VCO, and this is the incremental control voltage of the VCO. We evaluated the transfer function, and it turned out to be 1 plus SCR divided by 1 plus SCR plus S square. What was it? C by KVCO times ICT, right? Okay, and we also found the loop gain, which is basically ICP KVCO by S times R plus 1 by SC. So, this is the proportional path and that is the integral path. Okay, and for stability, the 0 1 by RC should be placed below the unity loop gain frequency. As it approaches the unity loop gain frequency, the damping factor reduces, and of course, this is a second order system. So, it does not actually become unstable in the sense that the poles do not go into the right half plane, but the poles go very close to the imaginary axis when you have ringing and so on. Okay? So, you need to do this. And if you satisfy this condition, omega u loop itself can be approximated from the proportional path to be ICP R KVCO, right? This is in radians per second. Okay. Now, of course, we evaluated the natural frequency and damping factor. The question is what to set the damping factor to. So, that we have to do by looking at different transfer functions. First, we saw that the loop gain itself has this shape. It changes from minus 40 dB per decade to minus 20 dB per decade at a frequency 1 by RC, and this is omega u loop. Okay. Phase starts from minus 180 degrees and approaches minus 90 degrees. Okay. So, if things are like this, of course, you have a very good phase margin of approximately 90 degrees. So, this happens if 1 by RC is much smaller than omega u loop. Okay. Now, approximately the closed loop transfer function, the closed loop transfer function is this in our case, and this can be approximated to be like that. Okay. This looks like a first order low pass. First order because eventually it has a slope of minus 20 dB per decade. Okay. And that is evident from the transfer function also, because you have 0 and 2 poles, eventually the roll off will be minus 20 dB per decade. Okay. So roughly speaking, we get a first order filtering from the input phase to the output. What this means of course is that low frequency input jitter will be followed with a gain of 1, and beyond the unity loop gain frequency it will be followed less and less, and well beyond that it won't be followed at all. Okay. Now let us look at some details of this. Now, what is the damping factor that we could choose? What damping factor do you want? So, okay, so first let us try a damping factor of 1. Okay. So, then if the damping factor is 1, the denominator will be of the form 1 plus 2s by omega n plus s square by omega n square, right. I mean, I do not want to sit and like evaluate the values of the damping factor, but is this clear? This damping factor 1 corresponds to two identical roots, right. So, both roots will be at two identical or repeated poles at s equals omega n. Okay, or rather minus omega, that is what it is. So, in this case what will be the transfer function? So, we it is very clear, right. This term here is what I am saying clear. I am just taking one example for zeta equals 1. Okay. I am not sitting and evaluating like ICP and all those things. I am just matching the terms in the transfer function to see what it looks like. So, obviously, the denominator has to be like this. Of course, 1 matches with 1 and this has to match with that. Okay. So, what will be omega n? What is omega n? If you do adjust it for zeta equal to 1, that is the general expression in this case. Just look at the 2 by RC. Okay. So, the whole thing will be 1 plus SCR divided by 1 plus SCR by 2 whole square. Okay. If you set damping factor equals 1, this whole thing will become corresponding to CR divided by 2 whole square. It has to be, right. Okay. Now, this one you can evaluate exactly and see, but the denominator, so let us say this is 1 by CR and this is 2 by CR. Okay. So, the denominator part will look like that with minus 40 dB per decade, right. That is, I am only taking 1 divided by the denominator. And if I look at only the numerator, what will that be? It will do that. Okay. At least in a Bode plot sense, the combination would be something like that, right. So, it will have eventually it will have minus 20 dB per decade attenuation. Of course, these things are not very far from each other. So, these will be smooth. Okay. But what I am trying to hint is the possibility of peaking, right. So, there will be peaking in the transfer function. And if you set the damping factor to be smaller, let us say damping factor equals half, even the 1 divided by denominator that itself will have peaking. Now, we also have a 0. So, which means it is going to increase with frequency. So, it will have it can have pretty high peaking. You can just evaluate this for different values of damping factor and see. Okay, the key is that this term here, the first two terms are the same in the numerator and denominator. Okay. So, such a transfer function will always have peaking. So, what does it mean to have peaking? at some frequency. What does it mean? I mean, here we are talking about the phase domain transfer function phi out by phi in, okay, and it has peaking. Peaking meaning its magnitude goes beyond 0 dB at a certain frequency, okay. What does it mean? I mean, is it good? Is it bad? Huh? No, that's not the. Now, I am particularly talking about the existence of peaking. What does that mean? The magnitude going above 1. No, in this case, there won't be any ringing anyway for zeta equal to 1. But that is not, I am not talking about that. What does it mean for the jitter? Let us say you apply an input data with some jitter. So, it actually makes the jitter worse, right, in that the output clock jitter can be higher than the input jitter, okay. That is because there is jitter amplification in this part, okay. If the jitter happens to be at that frequency, then if it is, if the input data is jittering at that frequency, then the output clock will jitter even more, okay. Now, is this good or bad? This is clearly bad. There may be cases where, I mean, this depends on what system we are talking about. There are some data transport systems like Sonnet, where you have data and inside you will have a CDR, and using the recovered clock you regenerate the data and then send it again. Okay, and then you have another similar system with the CDR inside. So, this can go through like a number of repeaters, right. Each one tries to recover the clock and using that clock retransmits the data, okay. The incoming data here, it may not be very clean, meaning it is can be jittery and its amplitude can be small. So, what it does is it first does data recovery and then has another transmitter there and using the recovered clock it retransmits the data. So, the data here is supposed to be clean. But if you do have jitter peaking, what can happen is that if the data is jittering at some frequency, here it will be jittering more and through the next repeater it will be jittering even more, and if it goes through a number of repeaters it can the jitter peaking can be a lot, okay. So, through each one it may, let us say, be 1 dB, but if it goes through like 20 of them you will have 20 dB of jitter peaking, okay. So, this jitter peaking is bad, very bad in systems like Sonnet, where you have a data regeneration from the same clock. And if zeta is smaller, you have higher peaking. This is always true, okay. If you have smaller zeta, you have higher peaking. But here it is not just a second order denominator, we also have a 0. So, that makes it even worse, okay, because the 0 tends to increase the high frequency stuff anyway, okay. So, a system like Sonnet has a very tight jitter peaking spec. It says jitter peaking has to be less than 0.1 dB, okay. which is very, very small, but the point is it can go through like 50 of these and then still work properly. Yeah? Which one? Yeah. I mean, zeta equal to 1 or even less than 1 you could use, depends on if you are want to allow a little bit of overshoot or not. Okay? If you allow a little overshoot, zeta equals let us say 1 over square root of 2 could also be used. Okay, as far as settling is concerned, yeah, that's true. But as far as jitter peaking is concerned, no. So now, if you want to, if you want this kind of stringent jitter, what do you have to do? Where do you have to place the zero? Let's say the unity loop gain frequency is here. So where should the zero be? Or what should be the damping factor? Okay, I want a really small jitter peaking of the order of let us say 0.1 dB. So, zeta equal to 1 does not seem to work. What kind of damping factor should I use? Much higher damping factor. Okay, so typically damping factor of 5 or something is what is used, right. I mean, in amplifiers you use damping factors close to 1 or half or something, but here you use you have to use to avoid jitter peaking a damping factor which is much higher than 1. Much more than 1, I do not mean like hundreds. Is it of the order of 5 or so? Okay. Now, let us say zeta is large, right. So, this zeta here in what can you say about the roots of this? This has two roots, right. So, when the damping factor is large, what can you say about the roots? One is that? Yeah, the two poles are far apart. Okay, that is what we can say. Okay, if the damping factor is much more than 1, then you will have two distinct real roots which are far from each other. Is this okay? So, I think you know this on the S plane, this is the real axis, this is the imaginary axis. So, if you go on varying zeta, what happens is that as you reduce zeta, they will come close to each other and then they will split and go that way. Okay? So, they become complex conjugate pair, but for large zeta, the two poles will be far from each other. Okay. Now, our denominator is 1 plus SCR plus S square C by KVCO times ICP. Okay. This is the denominator polynomial. Okay. So, tell me what will be the poles approximately, the P1 and P2. Do you know the approximation to use when a quadratic equation has roots very far from each other? How would you find the roots? Yeah, you can do that. Basically, when the roots are far from each other, so let us say you have ax square plus bx plus c equals 0 and it has two roots. like x1 and x2, and let us say x1 is very large and x2 is very small, or x1 is much more than x2. When I say x1, I mean the absolute value. Okay. Then what will happen is that of the three terms, for large x, this is most dominant, this is less and this is the least dominant. For small x, this is least dominant, this is more dominant and this is the most dominant. Okay. So, when you are calculating x1, you can neglect the least dominant term, which is c. Okay. Similarly, while calculating x2, you can omit the least dominant term, which is ax1, ax2 square. Okay. So, x1 is approximately what? Minus b by a, and x2 is approximately minus c by b. Okay. Now, if you write the general expression minus b plus minus square root b square minus 4ac by 2a and do the approximations, you will get something similar. Okay. You may get a slightly refined one as well. Okay. So, please find the roots when p1 and p2 are far from each other. What are the two roots of this polynomial? So, the low frequency pole is approximately minus 1 by RC, it just comes from these two terms, right. If you set the first two terms, sum of first two terms to be 0, you get S equals minus 1 by RC. And the other one, if you set the sum of these two to 0, minus, yeah, minus ICPR K VCO. Okay. So, now our closed loop transfer function phi out by phi in, we know that this is 1 by s, 1 plus SCR divided by 1 plus SCR plus S square C by KVCO times ICP. The 0 is at minus 1 by CR, and the two poles, the low frequency pole is approximately at minus 1 by CR. It turns out it will be at a slightly higher frequency than this. Okay. And the second pole is approximately at minus ICP R times KVCO. Okay. And this is when the damping factor is large. So, we have the poles separated from each other, okay, widely separated poles. In this case, this approximation holds. So, what can you say now? What will be the closed loop transfer function? What is the closed loop transfer function? What does it look like? Single pole at ICPR KVCO. Okay. In fact, it is exactly what we drew in our approximate plot, right. We had a single pole stuff and it is the pole frequency is at omega u loop, and omega u loop is in fact ICPR times KVCO, right. The only slight detail we have to add is that the 0 will be here at 1 by RC and the pole will be at a slightly higher frequency. Okay. This will always be the case, you can work out the algebra and see. So, what happens is that there will always be a slight jitter peaking. Okay. So at the zero it goes up, at the pole it flattens out. Of course, you can't see these segments at all because they are so close to each other, and then eventually it will fall off like that. Okay. So there will be always a jitter peaking. I mean, that's just the nature of that function, because we have 1 plus SCR. In the denominator also we have 1 plus SCR plus a square times something. So we will have pole zero doublet which are close to each other, but the pole will always be higher than the zero. So there will be some peaking. Okay. There will always be some peaking, but as you make the damping factor larger and larger, the peaking reduces. Okay. So for large damping factor, that approximation that we got based on just plotting the loop gain and saying that unity loop gain frequency equals the bandwidth, that is correct. So the closed loop bandwidth this is minus ICPR sorry is equal to omega u loop which is ICPR KVCO. Okay. Does it make sense? Why is this the bandwidth? I mean, does the expression for the bandwidth make sense? First of all, you are used to seeing expressions for bandwidth which are inversely proportional to R. It is here, it is directly proportional to R. Does it make sense? No, no, dimensionally it is correct, but so what is ICP times R? It is the voltage developed across the resistor, right? When there is a change of phase in the input data, right, there will be an extra voltage developed across the resistor, that is a pulse of height ICP times R. Okay. So, the larger it is or the larger the KVCO is, right, if there is a small change in the input phase, there will be large change in the output phase of the VCO, right, because you have to push the VCO phase by some amount that you do by changing the frequency. If you change the frequency by a lot, that phase change will also be a lot. So, if you push it by a lot more, then it can correct for a lot higher phase, this one. So, even at higher frequencies. So essentially it is just related to the loop gain, that is all, there is nothing special about it. So one of the parameters that you hear about in a CDR is known as jitter transfer, and this is abbreviated to JTRAN, and this is exactly what we discussed so far. It is phi out by phi in. Okay. How much of the jitter in the input data is transferred to the output clock? Okay. So that's a parameter that you commonly see in literature on CDR. Okay. Now another thing that you see is known as jitter tolerance, JTOL. Okay. Now what is this? You deliberately have jittery data input, or rather you have jittery data input. Okay. And let's say the jitter is sinusoidal at a certain frequency. Now what is this JTOL? It is the amplitude of the jitter that can be tolerated before the circuit fails. When I say circuit fails, the bitter rate increases beyond a certain value. So let's say we want a bitter rate of 10 to the minus 12, and then I add like a jitter at 1 megahertz, that is the sinusoidal jitter that is added to the data is at 1 megahertz. Then I go on increasing the amount of jitter, right? It is swinging back and forth by more, but still at 1 megahertz. Then I will see at what point the bitter rate increases beyond 10 to the minus 12. Okay, similarly, I can do the same thing with 10 kilohertz of jitter and so on. Okay, so this is amount of jitter that can be tolerated while maintaining the performance, meaning a bitter ratio less than some value. Okay. How do we calculate this? What do we have to calculate? We have the phase domain model, from that we have to figure this out. So, how do we go about doing that? So, what causes bit errors? Why would you have bit errors in a clock and data recovery circuit? What is the reason for having bit errors? Yeah, first there will be some random jitter in the system, okay, that also has to be included. But the point is, if the clock is in the middle of the data symbol, it will have the minimum bit error rate, and as it moves back and forth, it will have slightly higher bit error rate, because the probability of moving to the next symbol is higher, and once it moves beyond a certain point, bit error rate will go above a certain specification. Okay. So now, of course, exactly how much it can move, we do not know, but we will say that this is the symbol interval. And there is some range in the middle. Okay. So, by the way, this I have to introduce another unit here. If you do this in terms of phase, this is 2 pi, okay. And it is very common to use what is known as unit interval. This just corresponds to unit, one unit interval, basically one period. Okay. Things are normalized to one period. So, if you have phase, if you divide by 2 pi, you get the unit interval, that is all. Now, you could also do this in absolute time, in picoseconds and so on, but that is not preferred, because I mean that depends on the actual data symbol period that you have, right. So, whether 50 picoseconds of jitter, whether it is too much or too little, that depends on whether the data is at 10 gigabits per second or 1 gigabits per second. 10 gigabits per second, 50 picoseconds jitter is too much, but 1 gigabit per second, it is not all that much. Okay. So, that is why everything is normalized to unit interval. So let us say there is some region in the middle. Okay. I will call this 2 times phi x, something, some symbol, 2 times phi x. Okay. So, that is what I am saying is the clock has to be within this interval. In every symbol interval, the clock can be in the middle or plus minus phi x away from that. Okay. We do not know what phi x is, but that is okay, that will depend on the random jitter. Let us say that is some given. clock has to be within this interval plus minus phi x from the center to meet BER specifications. Okay. So, now how do I find the jitter tolerance? That is, what I want to find out is the amount of input jitter so that the clock will be in this region. Okay. And I have my phase domain model. So, what is it that I calculate now? What should I calculate? You understand the question? Finally, some D flip flop is clocking the data, and there is the data symbol interval, and the clock is supposed to be in the middle. It can deviate to the left or right by plus minus phi x. Even then, the D flip flop will have a bitter rate of less than the specification. But if it goes beyond that, it will increase beyond the specification. So, now what is it that I will calculate from my phase domain model? What I want to calculate is the amount of input jitter that can be tolerated while meeting the BER spec. Okay. Is it the output jitter that matters? Which is the jitter that I have to calculate? What does that mean? So, I have the data symbol and the clock has to be centered within the data symbol. Okay. And in my model, I have all these things. Okay. So, what is the quantity that measures whether the clock is centered within the data symbol in this model? Exactly. It is actually phi in minus phi out, right? It is not phi out, right? Because at low frequencies, phi out will be the same as phi in. That is okay, because the data is jittering, the clock is also jittering. That is actually good. So, that means that the clock is centered on the data. So, it is not phi out that matters, but phi in minus phi out. Okay? Is this fine? So, this means that this value has to be less than phi x. Okay. So, now please calculate the expression. What I want now, what I want to know is how much can phi in be so that this is satisfied. Okay. The jitter tolerance is nothing but the limit on phi in, right. Phi in is basically the input jitter. I want to find out how much of phi in I can have as a function of frequency so that this absolute value of phi in minus phi out is less than phi x. And this you understand, right? This is the what this phi in minus phi out. Phi out tells you just the absolute position of the clock. Phi in tells you the absolute position of the data. Phi in minus phi out tells you the relative position of clock with respect to data. That is what we are interested in. Okay. So, please calculate. That is what I want to know is the expression for magnitude of phi in such that phi in minus phi out, let us say equals phi x. I mean, it has to be less, what you calculate phi equals, that sets the limit. Okay. This is the condition. So, basically, okay. So, this is the jitter tolerance. Phi x is some number that we know, but in reality we just measure this jitter tolerance. Phi x will be there, that is based on the amount of random jitter that is there in the system and so on. And that only scales everything, right. Phi x could be, I do not know, maybe half the, it could span half the period or one quarter of the period. So, it only says that the clock should be within some interval. And 1 minus phi out by phi in. So, we know that phi out by phi in is 1 plus SCR, 1 plus SCR, S square C, ICP, KVCO. So, 1 minus that, what happens? So, the numerator becomes S square C by ICP, KVCO. Okay. And the reciprocal of that would be 1 plus SCR plus S square C by ICP KVCO S square C by ICP KVC. Okay. So what will this look like? So S square C by if you plot this versus omega, what do we get? What is it that we get? What is it at very high frequencies? Phi x. At very high frequencies, it is phi x. Why is that? Because at very high frequencies, the input data is jittery, but the output clock is not. It just gets filtered out, right? The output data, output clock has no jitter. So that means that the output clock is fixed. The data is jittering. The, how much can the data jitter? Well, only 5x, right? Because that's the amount of room you have. But as you go to lower frequencies, it will increase. So at very high frequencies, you can have just this 5x, whatever that level is. Now, this is at very high frequencies. This one. What is the crossover frequency between these two? What's the crossover frequency? I mean, when at very high frequencies this is dominant, at lower frequencies this is dominant. What's the frequency at which this starts becoming dominant? What's the frequency below which this starts becoming dominant? Yeah, it's the bandwidth of the CDR, right? ICPR KVCO. So below that, what happens is that the CDR, the output clock starts following the input data. So now, because it is following it, you can have even more jitter, right? So it increases like that. Okay, this slope is minus 20 dB per decade, and here this starts becoming dominant, and it will increase even faster. Okay, what is this frequency? The crossover between these two? It's the 0, 1 by CR. Okay. So this is the jitter tolerance curve. You could plot it in terms of phi n or in terms of unit interval. You just have to divide this by 2 pi, that's all. Okay. Here I have done it in terms of radians, but you could also do it in terms of the unit interval. Okay. Now in general, the jitter tolerance curves of most CDRs look like this. The details may be different. In this particular architecture, you have a slope of minus 40 dB and then minus 20 and 0. Maybe it will be just minus 20 and 0. It depends on what kind of architecture we use. Okay. But typically, you can always follow low frequency jitter. So at low frequencies, there will be very high jitter tolerance. Okay. But at high frequencies and beyond a certain frequency, there won't be any frequency dependence, because the output clock simply doesn't follow the input data. So, whatever jitter can be allowed, that is the tolerance. So, this is the JTOL curve. Okay. Is this fine? No, no. This is this jitter tolerance is a function of frequency. Okay. What this means is that if the input frequency, the jitter frequency is here, then you can tolerate that much jitter. Okay, if the jitter frequency is there, you can tolerate that much jitter and so on. So let's say phi x corresponds to 0.1 ui. That is, from the center you can go plus minus 0.1 of the cycle. Okay. At very high frequencies, how much data jitter can you tolerate? Also plus minus 0.1. Okay, because the output clock is simply not following the jitter. Now let's say you come to 1/10 of the bandwidth, 1/10 of omega u loop. Okay, then how much can you tolerate? 10 times that, right? You can tolerate a complete interval of jitter. I'll explain what this means. What is a complete interval of jitter? If you plot the ideal data without jitter and the actual data with jitter, so one interval of jitter means that there is actually some case where the edge, wherever it's supposed to be, it is coming one cycle later. But even that can be recovered. Okay, if it is at a low frequency. Low frequency means that the jitter doesn't change much from one period to the next. But let's say you look at one period and then some 1000 periods later, there could be lot of accumulated jitter. I mean, there is a little bit of jitter and little more and a little more and little more. So the edge would have moved a lot compared to the ideal one. Okay, I'll probably plot it and show. It's hard to draw that. So the frequency I was referring to was the frequency of the jitter. That is how fast the jitter is changing, right? If one edge moves to the right, the next one also moves to the right, and the next one also moves to the right. That's a low frequency jitter. Okay, but then if it alternates, that can be high frequency jitter. Okay, please think about this. We'll continue from here.